have to move. And why is that? Because during exercise, something magical happens, and these cells can start taking in glucose without insulin, or with extremely small amounts. Okay? So, I'll take questions afterwards if there's any part of this that's unclear. But remember, it's all about use it or lose it. And that holds true for cells and receptors also. And upregulation and downregulation is a crucial mechanism of all cells in the body. So, one favorite cartoon again, Glassbergen. This lady is talking to the doctor and says, "I think diabetes is affecting my eyesight. I have trouble seeing the consequences of poor food choices." I love it. So, how does this problem occur in the first place? And there's a lot of talk about something called glycemic index, and we'll talk very, very quickly about what that is. It basically measures how soon after you eat something has that been converted into sugar and entered the blood. So if something's converted very slowly and absorbed very slowly, it's said to have a low glycemic index. So low glycemic index are things like fat, protein, whole foods, vegetables, meat, fish, and nuts. In other words, most of the things that nature produces in their whole form. Something that is processed, something that doesn't need much digestion, that is almost sugar as you eat it, will get into the bloodstream almost instantly, and that's called a high glycemic index. So when you want to start controlling this, you need to look at glycemic indexes, and you want to keep them as, if you want to correct a situation that's already out of hand, you need to keep very, very, very low glycemic indexes. You basically cannot have any sugar or starch or anything like that. And don't be fooled when they say whole wheat or complex carbohydrates, because it is still a high glycemic index food. It will still get out very, very quickly. And in between, there's some medium glycemic index. Those would basically be beans and whole fruit. And let me make a note there that while a whole fruit has a medium glycemic index, if you juice it, it becomes a high glycemic index because you break up the cell walls and you take away all the fiber and all the sugar becomes available instantly. So a juice is not the same thing as a fruit. And when they say made from, that means it's not what it used to be. Simple as that. And another note on, I just use milk as an example, that because fat takes longer to process, and milk has both fat and lactose in it, which is a sugar, then if you drink whole milk, preferably raw whole milk, then the fat will balance out the sugar, so it becomes a medium glycemic index. Whereas if you drink a skim milk, you've taken all the fat away, so there's nothing to buffer the sugar, and that becomes a high glycemic index. Okay? So, understand the principles, and then you can figure things out for yourself. So now is the time to shake you up and scare you a little bit. And the people in this room, you already know a lot about this, I can tell. But think about people you know, and take this to heart. And realize that a lot of what we're talking about in all these sessions, it kind of applies across the board, even though we're just talking about diabetes today. Side effects and complications. Diabetes is the primary or contributing cause of death in 231,000 cases in 2007. That's a lot of people. The primary or contributing cause of death. Estimated costs $174 billion. And that's medical costs, work loss, and disability. So it's not just the expense, but at some point people are unable to maintain their work and they're disabled, which means they can't really enjoy life at all. Nervous system damage occurs in 60 to 70% of diabetes. That means that the sugar in the bloodstream is so much above where it's supposed to be that it starts penetrating the tissues around it, and it causes sugar in the tissues attracts water and causes swelling. So that's why you have vascular problems and neurological problems, because the vascularity, the blood is around the nerves as well, so it's going to choke off, close off blood vessels and nerves, and that is why diabetes is also the leading cause of blindness, because the blood vessels in the retina are so fine and so sensitive. The diabetic retinopathy is the leading cause of blindness. There's 4.2 million people with diabetic retinopathy. Leading cause of kidney failure. There's 202,000 people in chronic dialysis. They don't have any kidney function. They have to have them filtered because of diabetes. And it's again the vascular problem, blood vessels swelling. It's the leading cause of amputation. 65,700 cases of a complete leg amputation. And there's hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of cases where they start taking off one toe at a time because they lose their control, they lose the vascularity. So whenever they hit something and break something or break the skin, it doesn't heal again. Okay, the brain is shut off from the body part, means it can't do its business anymore. And also increases risk of heart disease, stroke, dental disease, coma, pneumonia, influenza, and depression. Do you need any more reasons? Okay. This is what quality of life is about. And we're talking about something that affects a huge, huge portion of the population. So, do you know anyone with insulin resistance? Someone who is pre-diabetic? Go ahead and just write down 5 people that you care about who could benefit from what you just learned. Just go down and scribble down some names real quick. So, consider letting these people know what we talked about, and consider bringing them next time that we talk about this or related topic, because it could save their life. Okay, this is serious business. Let's look at the prevalence, because if you don't think that you know anybody or that you're in good shape, then this is the prevalence in 2010, and this is from the National Institute of Health.gov website, the National Diabetes Information Clearinghouse. Diabetes affects 8.3% of the population. That's 25,800,000 people right now that have to take insulin. Then, when we get to ages above 65 years old, it affects 26.9% of the population that are diabetic. That's 10,900,000 people. That's a huge number. It's almost becoming the norm for people above a certain age to get these conditions. And we've seen that it's about upregulation, downregulation. It's a physiological adaptation to chronic stupidity. That's all it is. And it's a stupidity that is recommended by the American Diabetes Association and the American Heart Association and the 4 food groups and so on. Pre-diabetes, these are people who are insulin resistant with a greater risk. It's basically a matter of time before they develop this. And keep in mind, when we talk about these numbers, that we are the first generation to be exposed at this level. That the pre-diabetic people, a lot of them will become diabetic because this is the first time we've eaten like this. 35% of adults 20 years or older are pre-diabetic. That's 79 million people in this country alone are pre-diabetic. Those are some scary numbers. And when you get to the elderly 65 or older, it's 50%, 1 in 2. And we've just talked about the side effects and complications. So these people are heading for trouble. And it is completely reversed.